everybody. I got to tell you, it's great to be here in St. Louis, and I'm grateful to be here at such a critical time for Missouri, for our nation, and for our labor movement. Now, this hall is filled with leaders who have done so very, very much to protect working people. I mean all working people in Missouri. You've built strength through unity across industries and across crafts, across the length and the breadth of this great state. And this is the hard one in America in 2014. You've built it across party lines. Now, as a labor movement, I don't have to tell you that we face, once again, concerted attacks by those who have enormous, enormous wealth. The far right trying to divide us in many ways, but here in America, the power and the dignity of working people will always win as long as we stay united. Now, I'm going to stray from my usual convention speech, and I'm going to talk about something that may be difficult and maybe even uncomfortable. But I believe what I'm going to say absolutely needs to be said. See, the question of unity brings up a hard subject, a subject that all of us know about, but quite frankly, few want to acknowledge, and that's race. I'm talking about race in America and about what that means for our communities, what it means for our movement, and what it means for our nation. Because the reality is that while a young man named Michael Brown died just a short distance from us in Ferguson from gunshot wounds from a police officer, other young men of color have died and will die in similar circumstances in communities all across this country. You see, it happened here, but it could have happened and does happen everywhere in America, because the reality is we still have racism in America. Now, some people might ask me why our labor movement should be involved in all that's happened since the tragic death of Michael Brown in Ferguson. And I want to answer that question directly. How can we not be involved? You see, union members' lives have been profoundly damaged in ways that can't be fixed. Leslie McSpadden, Michael Brown's mother, who works in a grocery store, is our sister and an AFL-CIO union member. And Darren Wilson, the officer who killed Michael Brown, is a union member too, and he's our brother. You see, our brother killed our sister's son. And we don't have to wait for the judgment of prosecutors or courts to tell us how terrible that very thing is. So I say again, how can we not be involved? See, this tragedy and all the complexities of race and racism are a big, big part of our very big family. And they always have been. See, a union's like a home. And in any home, good things and bad things happen. And we have to deal with all of them, honestly. But that's a philosophy. And we can't leave it at that. We have to look at real life today. We can't wash our hands of the issues raised by Michael Brown's death. Now, that doesn't mean that we prejudge the specifics of Michael Brown's death or deny Officer Darren Wilson or any other officer his or her rights on the job or in the courts. But it does demand that we clearly and openly discuss the reality of racism in American life. See, we have to take responsibility for the past. Now, racism, unfortunately, is part of our inheritance as Americans. Every city, every state, and every region in this country has its own deep history with racism. And so does the labor movement. See, right here in St. Louis in 1917, powerful corporations replaced white workers with African American workers, recruited from the Mississippi Delta with offers of wages far, far higher than anyone could ever make sharecropping. And in response, the St. Louis labor movement helped lead a bloodbath against the African American community in East St. Louis. Now, no one really knows how many men and women and children were killed, and how many houses and businesses were burned. But the NAACP estimated that up to 200 died and 6,000 were left homeless. Now, Eugene V. Debs, the founder of the National Railway Union, called the East St. Louis massacre, and I quote, "a foul blot on the American labor movement." Now, it was one of the single most violent events in the history of American racism. And it scarred this city. And it scarred our labor movement. And it scarred our country. See, when I think about an event like that, and there are plenty in our history all over this great country, and not all of them so long ago, I really wonder what those white workers would say if they could stand here, right here today where we are. What would they say about the choices to embrace hatred and division over unity and strength? What would they say about corporate bosses playing the race card over and over and over again in the years after 1917, breaking unions, crushing hopes, and dashing out our dreams? Yet remember, we're here today because labor leaders like A. Philip Randolph and Walter Reuther showed us that there's a better way, not just for our unions, but for our entire country. But this is not just about leaders of the past and tragedies of yesterday. You see, if we in the labor movement truly want to act as a positive force for change around issues of racism and classism, well, then we have to acknowledge our own shortcomings. We as a movement have not always done our best to support our brothers and sisters of color who face challenges both on and off the job. Challenges that you really don't understand unless you live them day in and day out. See, the test of our movement's commitment to our legacy is not whether we post Dr. King's picture in our union halls, but rather, do we take up the fight when the going gets tough, when the fight gets real, against the evils that still exist today? When a new immigrant gets mistreated by management because they don't speak the language, that's our fright. When an African American worker doesn't get a promotion or fair pay because of the color of his or her skin, that's our fight. When women are paid less than men for the same work, that's a fight for every single one of us. You see, we can't afford any longer to have my issues and your issues. We must all stand together and mobilize around our issues. You see, we have a choice. We can either live our history or we can change it. Now, as you may be able to tell, the matter is deeply personal with me. See, when I sat at my conference table at the AFL-CIO, I look across the office at a picture of my dad. Now, he's gone. But if you've lost a parent, you know that they never stop talking to you, no matter how long. My dad was a miner, 44 years worth. He helped build the United Mine Workers. He bled for his union. And he went to war for our country in the Pacific in World War II, 52 months of it. And as I worked on this speech, this is what my dad said to me. He reminded me of something that happened when I was 5 or maybe 6 years old. You see, I come from a coal mining town in southwestern Pennsylvania called Nemacolin. And my best friend back then was a kid named Tom. And Tom was African American. And there was a park near us. It was called Shady Grove Park. It had a big swimming pool in it where you could pay to swim. And one day my dad drove us there to go swimming. And we came up to the toll booth to pay. It was one of those places where you pull up and pay for everyone that's in the car. And the guy looks in and sees Tommy in the car, and he tells my dad, he said, "That boy can't swim here. You know that. You know that he can't." My dad never raised his voice. But he said, "You better take out for that boy, because we're going to swim here." Now, I don't know whether they took out for Tommy or not. But we went in, and me and Tommy went to the changing room, and we jumped into the pool. And it was a hot day, and the pool was packed. Wasn't any room anywhere. But it was like all of a sudden where we went, a circle of water opened up all around us. And when we moved, the circle of clear water just moved around wherever we went. Well, we swam until we got tired, and then we got out and we dried off and we got something to eat, and that was that. Later, I asked my dad about the man in the booth. I wanted to know why he didn't like Tommy. And my dad explained that it didn't have anything to do with Tommy, but with the color of Tommy's skin. I protested. I said, "That's not fair." My dad said, "That's the whole point." So let me come back to what happened at Ferguson specifically. It isn't fair. And that's the whole point. See, I have a son. He's not so young anymore, but he's not so old. And I don't worry about him. Well, maybe a little bit. I don't know, but I have a suspicion, like many of you, and certainly like me at that age, that he may not always obey the nation's traffic laws. So while I worry that he might wrap himself around a tree, I never worry that when he goes for a cross-country road trip or a a night on the town that he may be stopped and shot to death by a police officer. But for millions of mothers and fathers of young African-American men and boys, men just like my son, and boys that were as young as me and my friend Tommy, kids with promising futures in America, that's a constant fear. A constant fear. And if you don't feel that fear yourself, I just ask you, just for a moment, to think about what it would be like to feel that every time your son went out that door. See, think about what it would be like to watch your kid walk out the door and wonder, with good reason, if it's the last time you'll ever see him alive. Because we know it happens. And if you haven't had a close call yourself, you know, people who have, friends, family, neighbors, people you worship with, and it doesn't stop there, unfortunately. See, teenagers of all races often experiment with drugs, but only some of our sons and daughters are suffering terrible long terms in prison for the same nonviolent petty crimes which we all know some of the people in this room did as kids as well. And you can't get around the fact that those prisons are filled disproportionately with people of color. And that's not somebody else's problem, brothers and sisters. This is the reality of life for millions of our brothers and our sisters. And so it's our problem. And that's what solidarity means. Now, brothers and sisters, I know there are no easy answers. Well, we must use the occasion of the tragic death of Michael Brown and its aftermath here in St. Louis to begin a serious and open-ended conversation about what we can do and about what we should do. See, the conversation that needs to be about racism and some other things as well. Call it classism. Call it for the blindness of our nation, of all the poor, of all races and nationalities. Call it contempt for the people who do the work in our country. But it needs to be addressed. Because consider this. We live in a country of runaway inequality, of widespread desperation, amid staggering, staggering wealth. And in truth, we asked our public sector workers to manage this for us. And then our politicians and our media blame them no matter what happens. Blame the teacher in the defunded school, the firefighter with 20-year-old equipment, and the nurse who's given yet another 12-hour shift. And think about what it means to be a police officer in this country, where violence is so often the norm. Think about walking up to a car, anticipating the worst over and over again, every single day. Now, none of us can really know the toll that that takes unless we've worn the uniform and walked in those shoes. So this reality, this experience, must be part of any conversation about how we move forward from what has happened here in Ferguson. But the answer starts with candor, not firepower. See, we can't militarize our police. A free society is policed by a civilian police force, democratically accountable to the community that it protects. Now, of course, our officers need the equipment and the training and the staffing to protect themselves and to protect us. But let's not forget what our history teaches us, because it's always the employers who want the paramilitary forces, the National Guard, the bayonets and the armored cars, and the weapons always end up pointed at us. And the decision to militarize is always made way up the chain of command, not by the citizenry or by the rank and file police officers. So we've got to talk to each other, not past each other. And we've got to talk about how to help our police officers serve our community. We've got to talk about registering and educating voters about jobs and housing and about raising wages for all of us. And we've got to talk about accountability, making sure the public has confidence that the laws our nation will be enforced, and enforced equally and fairly. And we have to do more than just talk. First, we have to listen, and then we have to act. See, I'm not saying this is easy. If I knew how to fix the hurt in our communities, I would tell you. I honestly would. But I do know how to start, and that's by listening. So later today, I'm going to be doing a lot of listening, here at this convention, and then at a meeting in Ferguson with the leaders of that working class community. Because we as a labor movement have to be part of the communities that our members live in. Brothers and sisters, just as it was true 100 years ago when we try to move forward, there will be people who will try to foment racism, try to divide us, separate us for their own benefit. And those are the same people who always want to set workers against each other, private sector workers against public sector workers, native born against immigrants. And about that, I can only say this. If we let that happen, we lose every time. Not once in a while, not occasionally, but we lose every time we're allowed to be divided. So it's time to draw the line. Some people are still getting hurt in our communities because of the color of their skin, and that's not right. One moment of bad luck, one dumb mistake, one misstep shouldn't end a life. Nor should it put someone in prison for decades and rob them of the right to participate in our democracy for the rest of their lives. See, that's nothing but second-class citizenry, and that's wrong in America. And we can do better. See, the United States of America is the greatest country in the world. It's a beacon of hope. The very name America means freedom. It means fairness. It means justice. It means equality. And facing our problems, facing our flaws, is part of our greatness. Now, I know each and every one of you, became involved in our labor movement because you hunger for justice. You hunger for fairness. It's in your blood and your DNA. And you've learned the hard way that justice and fairness just don't happen. We have to make it happen. We have to build power. And we have to use that power to fight. And we can never stop. Because in this country, in the richest nation on earth, at its most rich point in time in history, fairness and justice really aren't too much for us to be asking for. Whatever the color of our skin, whoever we love, no matter our gender, our religion, or anything else, because we're the workers of America. From the hotel to the high school, we lay the foundations. We teach the classes, we drive the buses, we build the roads. Brothers and sisters, we lift the loads and answer the call. We do whatever it takes, no matter the cost. We wake our country up every morning, every single day. We tuck her to bed every night, and we won't be turned aside, and we won't be divided. This is our country, and it is time we took this country back for every last worker out there, black, yellow, red, and brown. You know, earlier I said that I hope the tragedy of Ferguson can push us to make positive change. And I'm hopeful this change has already begun to happen. I know that I've been changed. Yet as a community, we have a long, long way to go. And we have a lot of work to do. Now, I don't have to tell anyone here how our labor movement operates. We carry out our activism in our communities, in the workplace, and we carry out our activism at the ballot box. And quite frankly, we're ramping up all three of those right now. And it's a good thing, too, because the time is right. You see, for 40 years, we've been living a story of decline. And so much of what made our country great has been pushed into despair as our roads and bridges crumble and fall away, and public investment in social services and public education and housing and transportation and research and medicine have all been cut so that politicians can give more tax cuts to the super rich, especially the 0.1%, not even the top 1%. And for decades, the far-right CEOs and billionaires have sought to divide us, to disempower us. In the past few years, we've seen a rash of voter ID laws to deny the vote to millions of people of color, to young people, and to the elderly. We've seen the demonization of immigrants. We've seen workers vilified. We've seen our rights attacked in Wisconsin and Ohio and Indiana and Michigan and right here in Missouri. But I got to tell you, that's the old story. There's a new story in America. And it doesn't come from Washington or our politicians. You see, working people are coming together for a change. We're standing together in the workplace, in the polling place, and in the streets. People are talking about collective action and economic inequality. People are talking about collective bargaining who never spoke the words before. We've marched together with fast food workers who demand fairness and dignity and a $15 an hour wage right here in St. Louis. And I gotta tell you, my hat's off to those courageous workers. God love each and every one of them. And how about the Walmart workers taking on the richest family and the largest private employer in the world? And how about the men and women, predominantly people of color, who drive and fix the buses and staffs the metro system right here in St. Louis, no pay raise in 6 years. Now, I heard last night that a tentative deal was reached to save pensions. And while it's still subject to agency notification and union ratification, I really want to thank Mayor Slay for his help coming together and standing up for workers. Mayor, I know you're still in the room, and all I want to do is say thank you for standing up and talk and walking the walk, not just talking the talk. Let's give that man a round of applause for standing with workers. And how about the Missouri AFL-CIO? I gotta tell you, I can't begin to tell you how proud I am of you. You built a bipartisan coalition to defeat right to work. Our opponents thought it was a done deal, and it wasn't, and it won't be. You see, we're living a new story in America. You see, working people stand united in our desire for economic change. And a powerful majority, not just union members, want the minimum wage raised. And an even larger majority wants good American manufacturing jobs and a rebuilt infrastructure, not more bad trade deals and corporate tax ripoffs. So between now and November 4th, we collectively, all of us, have a chance to show candidates that supporting a working family's agenda, our agenda, America's agenda, is a sure way to win. We can demonstrate how powerful unity is, and we can win for candidates who want to raise wages and who will represent all of us and who will make work lift us up, not hold us down and trap us in poverty. You see, right now we have a chance to grow power for Missouri's working families with our political program across our society. And in that effort, we need every single one of you, every single one, to fully engage in Labor 2014. If you haven't released staff, release staff. Unless, of course, you like things the way they are. If you do, if you think this economy has just been wonderful to you and we'd be even greater to your kids, do nothing. Do nothing. But if you think we ought to change, then we got to do it to keep our right to work and to defeat the constitutional amendment attacking teachers' tenure. So we need you in the phone banks. Lead by example, knocking on doors. We need the face-to-face conversations. You see, that's how we win elections. I'm doing it. You go to the AFL-CIO and go in the phone bank, you'll see me there. You'll see me knocking on doors. You'll see me leafleting. You know why? Because when our members see us doing it as leaders, they know it's important. And they come out too. You can't sit behind a desk and tell everybody else to go do stuff unless you're willing to do it too. See, I want to tell you something. If you think we're in trouble now, it's going to get much worse if we don't get off our butts and work like hell between now and November 4th. So, let's wake up before it's too late. Let's motivate those volunteers and strengthen our activists. We'll connect with more working class voters and we'll get more working families to the polls. And we need to be out in our communities building larger working class political alliances. See, that's how we break the isolation. That's how we fight racism. And that's how we win. Because we have a vision. We have a big vision of a better nation. And we're making it real, brothers and sisters, because when all of us pitch in, we begin moving forward together in solidarity, because we can learn from even the worst tragedy, because all of us together have the power to make a new day for America. So let's get off our seat and on our feet, brothers and sisters, because when we stand together and fight together, we win together. We'll work for it. We'll fight for it together, all of us together, with solidarity, real solidarity, black and white, immigrant and native form, gray and straight, where your picket line is my picket line, and I honor that picket line without asking what the strike's about. My brothers and sisters are fighting, I fight with them, right? Arm in arm, every day, every single day, standing together, fighting together, voting together, winning together for a better America, a better tomorrow, and a better future. God bless you. Keep up the fight.